I want you guys to pray for the Philippines. So this basketball court, I was here 2 months ago in Mobile, and guys were playing on this court all day. In fact, I did some videos of this court, the guys playing. And here 2 months later, it's gotten worse, the whole restrictions. Now they put trash bags on the basketball hoops. Please, please pray for the Philippines, that God will open up the Philippines and allow kids to play again. This is just so discouraging and so frustrating. I mean, tried to start a ministry here and they're not allowing the kids to play. So I know God's got a reason for it, for all things work together for good, that for them that are called according to his purpose. So I know there's a reason for this in this time, but I would just really ask you guys to pray for the Philippines, that God will allow them to open up and allow the kids to continue to play. How exciting that first clinic's gonna be, that first game, once they do open up. Just the joy, the excitement, the passion, the hope, and for the future. Hey guys, Coach Corsi here with California Philippines Bearcats, coming to you from Mobile's Cebu. We're having a great time here. The only thing that's not good about this area right now, or most of the Philippines, is that the restrictions have gotten even tougher, and so they're really not allowing the kids to play at all, which has really been a source of disappointment. For me, but we're finding many ways to help people as we do on a daily basis. Hey, today I want to continue with John Wooden, and this is going to be called The Age of Alcindor. Lew Alcindor, most of you guys know him as Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, won 3 national championships with UCLA, probably would have won 4, but at that time freshmen could not play varsity. So one of the things that John Wooden said he was really impressed with right from the beginning with meeting Lewis Alcindor, or Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. I'll call him Kareem Abdul-Jabbar for this video because I think it makes it easier because everybody knows that name. And he said that Kareem Abdul-Jabbar was, what he was impressed with was not only that he was 7 foot, but he was really impressed with his demeanor, his self-control, his poise. He said that he had powerful self-control and poise, which he'd really never seen in a player before. He says it very much reminded him of his father and the self-control and poise that his father had. So right away, John Wooden and Kareem Abdul-Jabbar really hit it off on the basketball court. So as they decided to play in 1965, everybody in the press assumed, after winning back-to-back championships in 64 and 65, that John Wooden was a shoo-in for the national championship. He had a brand new Pauley Pavilion. He had the best player in the country, arguably maybe one of the greatest players of all time at that time. And so everybody thought, like, hey, you know, he's a shoo-in. But John Wooden began to learn, and he talks a lot about this, is you really can't win without athletes. But he began to say that there's a lot of coaches that don't win even with talent. So it's not easy to win with talent, is what he was trying to say. And I completely agree with that. You still gotta coach them up. You gotta create that team atmosphere. And so as they went into that season, a reporter started asking, like, hey, are you a shoo-in for the national championship? He said, no, we're gonna go to practice. We're gonna work hard. We're gonna get better. That's really all I care about. The other things that he talked about is he needed to guard against jealousy and complacency because they had a great team. I mean, players like Lucius Allen, players like Lynn Shackelford, players like Cindy Wicks that were all great NBA players, all played with Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. So he had to really guard against that jealousy and complacency that could really arise from the team. And he said a couple things really helped. It was number one, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar was very team-oriented. He was more concerned about the team and winning than he was about his own accolades. So that really helped. But also what he said, what John Wooden would do is when he would talk to reporters after the game and Kareem Abdul-Jabbar had just scored 30 points, he would first bring up another player that played very well, constantly compliment other players before he even talked about Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. And the reporters, that's all they wanted to talk about. They wanted to talk about this 7'2" sensation. And he would always bring up other players on the team first before he even talked about it, to give them credit, constantly giving the rest of the team credit, even though all anybody wanted to talk about was Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. And he used to tell his players that a team is like making a movie. You know, every movie has the star, which was Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. But that movie doesn't get made without the supporting actor, actress, the co-stars, the producer, the director. Everybody, and he explains to him that everybody has a role. And yes, we know there's a star, which is Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, but everybody else has a role to play in order for this team to be successful. The other thing he talked about with Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, which I'll get into, and I really want to spend most of this video talking about Kareem Abdul-Jabbar as a person and as a team member, is he was never rude, and he was never ruffled by all the comments. I mean, he said people would come up to him and they treated him, you know, John Wood said it really bothered him because sometimes people would treat him like he was a circus act, just this big, you know, this big guy was like a circus act. And some of the comments were extremely rude. Some of the comments were very racist. And it never, and John Wooden would really talk to Kareem Abdul-Jabbar as the person's not trying to be rude. They're just amazed and just bewildered by how tall you are and how you hold yourself. And, you know, they said that Kareem Abdul-Jabbar knew that it was more than that, but he never let it bother him. He was never extremely rude, and he was never really flustered by it. So he said that during his time that Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, he was so impressed with his poise, his character, and his self-control while he was at UCLA, even in really tough situations. He talked about how, you know, even though Kareem Abdul-Jabbar had to deal with so much off the court, hotel rooms, beds that didn't fit, doorways he had to duck under, plane seats didn't fit, you know, getting the right shoes that didn't fit. I mean, it's just, he said the laundry list of things that Kareem Abdul-Jabbar had to deal with off the court versus even on the court was a tremendous amount of things. And he never complained, he never whined, he never got upset, not one time in his entire stay with UCLA. It really is a tremendous credit to Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. I think he was a very, very controlled, poised person. I had a chance to meet Kareem Abdul-Jabbar on more than one time because I was in the athletic industry, and he was wasn't very friendly, but he was very calm, very subdued. He was a man of few words. He wasn't flamboyant. I also met Magic Johnson, who was very flamboyant and social and wanted to talk to you. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar was never like that, but he did have tremendous poise and control. A lot of people don't talk about his talent, and you know, a lot of people would say that he might be the greatest basketball player of all time. It's just he played so much earlier on than Magic Johnson, Larry Bird, Michael Jordan, and so forth and so on. So it's really great diving into who Kareem Abdul-Jabbar was. And I think it's really good for you as a coach to understand when you have extreme talent that you don't spend all your time focused on that talent. I've met a lot of coaches where they so focused on that one person then they forget about the rest of the team, and it really does create a tremendous amount of resentment and jealousy, and it really ruins that cohesive team atmosphere. And I've seen this happen over and over again in watching other teams in my coaching career is when a coach isn't educated or smart and really spends all his time focused on that star player, really ruins the core values and the core of that team, and those teams usually don't win. And I've seen that over and over where they had one player who was just out of this world talented, but as a team, they couldn't win. And you could feel and see the resentment from the rest of his players on the team, where at times they wouldn't even pass the ball to the star player. They would take it on their own because they were tired of the favoritism to that star player. So you really gotta be careful with that, because in your coaching career, you eventually will have some real studs, some real ballers. And you got to make sure that you keep that cohesiveness and one team, one goal, everybody rowing on the same boat. Everybody has their own talents and their own things that they bring to the table. That it's one team, we all contribute for the ultimate goal, and that's success. You know, loving that scoreboard. So anyways, I hope you enjoyed this. We're really having a great time here. Please pray for the Philippines that God will intervene and they'll open up and they'll let the kids start to play. That's my prayer, my hope for this country. And as we are here, we're trying to do everything that we can to help and encourage and just step in and help people that we meet. So that's it for today. Hope you enjoyed this video, and thank you for your love and your support, and go Bearcats! Hey guys, Coach Corsi here. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe and like, and thanks for being a part of this vision for the future to impact our youth and the next generation. God bless you, and go Bearcats.